provides things like you can audit the packages that are installed on all of your systems and your infrastructure. You have the ability to check errata, so you can target like non-compliant servers so that you're always up to date on security. And you can also define certain roles. So during your deployment process, you want to start all the way from dev and run all the way up to production. So the types of repositories and content management systems that are supported in Catello currently, you have RPMs. They just got support for Docker repositories, so you can actually integrate your through the Docker Hub registries or your internal Docker registry. You can also sync if you want to control your own Puppet repositories. It also supports Puppet content. And you can actually, as Justin was saying earlier, you can actually, if you have Red Hat subscriptions, you can actually sync your Red Hat repository straight from the Red Hat network or the Red Hat channel into Foreman and use Foreman as your content management for all of your Red Hat servers. Oh, and with Docker, you can sync from, as I said, an internal registry or Docker Hub registry. By default, it is linked to, it's set up to sync from Docker Hub. And you also have the ability to upload your own images. It supports tar files. And then your Puppet content, you can either import your Puppet modules from the Puppet Forge. I'm sure a lot of you use Puppet Forge if you use Puppet. Or you can actually also import from Git repository as well. So Foreman uses what's called a product. And this is what you actually register. You actually register a product to each one of your hosts. So a definition of a product is a group of content. So you know, each repository inside that product, if I want also to have a Docker registry and public content as well. So you, every node gets registered to a product. Another nice feature is you can also schedule syncs of all of your repositories, so you don't actually have to log in, run a command. This will, if you want to set it up on hourly, weekly, monthly, yearly, whatever you want to do, it will do it automatically for you.
One thing I want to mention about products that I thought was pretty cool, I haven't gotten working yet, but so products can be aware, have a flow to them where you have a dev, QA, production type flow, and servers are tagged that way, so and it has a promotion flow to it. So you can say, deploy the latest errata to dev, go. And your people go, your dev test, make sure nothing breaks, click promote, promotes it to QA, people test, whatever, click promote again, and it promotes it to production. And you have that control flow by product, if you want. I'm not actually using it because I don't really have a dev or QA for Hadoop.
It's way better than the way Satellite 5 used to do it, where you'd like clone channels and try to track all that.
It's a mess.
It was difficult to do.
It's also a waste of space as right. well. Yeah. I mean, some of your repositories, I mean, if you want to sync eval, for example, that's tens of gigs, tens of maybe even hundreds of gigs, depending on what you enable. So that's cool. Another nice feature of Catello is you have the ability to register or select host into a host collection. So if I want to have a host collection of my Hadoop nodes over here and my production web servers over here, I can actually separate which products actually get registered to each collection of hosts. Alongside with host collection, there's also a feature called bulk actions, where you it actually gives you the ability to log into the UI and can run an install, upgrade, or remove of a single package. Maybe it supports multiple packages, I've never tried it before, on the entire host collection or a selection of hosts that are within that host selection. So, for example, I don't know, there's a security issue with Bash. You log in and select which which hosts are vulnerable and within the host group, and you can just type, I want to install Apache, and I'll demo how this works next. But it allows you to do this in a batch instead of actually logging into individual servers.
Can I make so the font larger?
Sorry?
Can you make the fonts larger?
It's a video.
It's a video.
We can try to make it.
Oh, well.
Register our nodes that are already built with the Catello server. So we need to do a couple things. We need to install the Bootstrap RPM first, and then we're going to actually define the activation key. An activation key is to the server, which actually will allow you to register with Catello without having to sign anything or have the admin credentials.
And that Bootstrap RPM, what it's doing is installing the certificates. So that's why it's allowed to. So when you hit Subscription Manager Register, the reason it's able to authenticate is because it's got certificates now. Saying you can have this happen automatically, you still need to do it. So the auto-provisioning stuff we were talking about, you edit your kickstart scripts or your Puppet, depends what point in the cycle you want to happen, to do these commands.
I forgot to actually have Subscription Manager installed on this, so I couldn't install the CA right away. So there I installed the CA. And here's, now I want to register it with an activation key. And the activation key is actually tied to a product, which is actually tied to the repositories that I would want to have registered to the host.
Or multiple products, right?
Or multiple products, yes. So I add the activation key, you'll see a message from Subscription Manager saying that it's been registered. So now I go into the actual host collection here. At some point, I was having a lot of difficulties using his trackpad.
Yeah, I have an IBM ThinkPad. So it has this awesome feature when you click it, the whole thing goes down. So it's really hard to right click.
So here I created a host collection called Ohio Linux Fest. And now I want to add this host that I just registered to the host collection.
It
auto registered because I installed the activation key. So now we're going to take us through the process of actually running a bulk action. So here as an example, install Nano on all of the servers. Click install, and this is great. You just need to run an installation on a single package right now, or maybe it's a couple of packages. So now when I log back in, you can see that Nano actually is already installed. Done. The log action, I think, is really cool because it, in an emergency, something like a bash vulnerability, for example, it gives you the ability to just log into the host collections and run a bulk action against, I mean, here I have three, you can run it against thousands of servers at one time.
And this, so now that they're registered in as a content host, that's different than Puppet. So there's kind of two registration systems. If I point something to my Puppet server and update it, it'll auto add to Puppet, right? But it won't be in this system. I still have to install a Subscription Manager agent. But now that it's in Subscription Management, I can audit all errata. So I can update my errata from Red Hat, tell me what servers have, are not compliant on another UI, it's under monitor. and target them by product to update at my, you know, at my convenience. But they are two separate registration systems, so you can see it's kind of still coming together.
So use this one like CentOS and Fedora? I mean, is that a subscription?
So I only use CentOS, so that's a great question.
Right.
You can, there's a script to convert Red Hat errata for CentOS, so you can pull off all the CentOS errata and update as well. For Ubuntu, I don't know. We can do repository management, like apt repos. I know we can mirror those and push those out, but I don't know how errata works with Ubuntu yet, since we're not on the production Ubuntu servers yet.
Well, they also support Solaris. I've never worked with Solaris, but you can also, I'm assuming that they would do like the same type of repository as well, but it does support. Do you have your Solaris repositories within Forman and Capella as well?
And we don't have a lot of experience with Solaris.
I don't have any experience with using Solaris.
Are you guys cloning repositories locally? Or
yes. Uses Pulp behind the scenes.
Yeah, it uses, if you've ever heard of Pulp. Yeah, so it's, like I said earlier, you can actually schedule this to run, you know, daily, hourly, every 15 seconds if you want, to automatically go out to the URLs and download it locally. Like, it just makes things run much quicker if you have it locally, right? You're not reaching out. You know, some security precautions there as well. Like, if you're not allowed to have, you know, your server going out to the internet or whatever. So to kind of bring the two together and kind of automate everything from start to finish, all you simply do is when you, during your deployment process of your servers, you just have your defined in your host group which kickstart or provisioning scripts to point to the different activation keys that contain the different products and repos. So bringing the two projects together, essentially, I mean, you saw what how you provisioned. You just include the Catello activation keys into the provisioning process, and then it's, you know, it's registered into Puppet. It's registered into your repository management system as well.
One thing I also like about how it does partitioning, so managing partitions for new hosts. So you can assign different partition templates by the host group level and still get inheritance from the other Kickstart stuff, and it's dynamically generated into your Kickstarts because you know, you have different disk setups for different types of hosts. There's also a scripting language that I haven't figured out how to use yet that you can have it detect, like do a for loop on all disks and add those to be partitioned with whatever partition method you want and formatted. It looks really cool. It's kind of hard. It takes a long time to test on bare metal because it takes like 3 hours for my nodes to format.
So the first time you actually had this fully automated the whole way, I was like, dude, I have got to show Justin this. I know one of the issues he's having at the moment is, you know, he's having to install hundreds of nodes at one time. It's taking, you know, weeks or months, right? Yeah, and this just completely, you automate it from start to finish. I mean, you get your repositories automatically synced. Puppet set up for all your configuration. It's just,
and the Puppet environment class management thing was just really killer for me because I was reading about how to do it with some extra Puppet modules and how to do it all on command line. It was just real painful, but I didn't want to let certain people hack, be able to edit, you know, put stuff in my environments. And from the command line with Puppet, there's no real way to do that kind of restriction access that I could find. And it's just, as I was having the problem, he told me about it. I was like, oh, yes, done. Now these people can only access the web UI, lock them out of the SSH, and can only edit the servers we allow them to.
How much time did you guys invest having to learn?
From the beginning, without any guidance, I spent about 3 months.
A lot. Still learning it.
Then I found out Red Hat had all the docs. When I was done.
Have you compared it to any of the other products that are out there, like the Ansible and Cockpit?
So. Kind of covers a lot of areas that aren't. The only comparable product I found is Ubuntu Metal as a Service, MaaS. I actually think MaaS is even a little cooler in some regards because I can just say, give me Postgres, and it'll just pick hosts and install it on them, and you gave an SSH into them. I used MaaS for a OpenStack POC. But for servers I already have in place, I would never use Mask because it tries to automate a little too much, especially if it's connected to VMware. It can't wipe disks in VMware, and if you delete all the services and deploy to a host, it will automatically wipe all your disks. That's a Mass feature.
A Mass feature.
The one thing that I find that's so mind-blowing about this project is that it allows you, for those of us that have, you know, hybrid cloud, where we're having public, private cloud, and then also having physical infrastructure that we have to maintain, this tool allows you to maintain everything from a single tool. Cloud agnostic.
I like that it integrates a bunch of tools that you feel like always should be integrated in the first place. Like, I was using a separate server for imaging stuff, and then once that was done, I would go manually add it to Puppet, and then apply host roles, and after classifying it, Puppet as a node manually, and then, you know, it was just a lot of manual extra work. But if I was like, man, maybe someday I'll write a shell script that'll like integrate this stuff with awk or something, or Perl. And I was like, oh man, that's going to be really hard. So I never did.
And then
it showed up.
It's amazing. I've been taking a look at this product over probably the past like 10 months. And just in that 10-month time frame, like how much further developed it's become, and the community has just gotten huge.
And for like Ansible integration, it doesn't tie in as well for lifecycle environment and classes. I can tell Puppet was the first class citizen here. But the fact that I can tie in the Ansible for inventory, so I really like, you know, Ansible facts. You can use Puppet facts in Ansible now when you use this as inventory, which we wrote custom modules to give us facts based on certain things we had deployed. So now I can detect that with Ansible and do quick pushes. So I use Ansible for just quick giving you this across a bunch of nodes. Because it takes a while to go edit some public stuff, and if it's not something I need to always be consistent for all nodes, well, a lot of times actually I'll just do it ad hoc with Ansible, and then figure out over the next couple of days how to do it in Puppet and go apply it back for all the nodes to get that. But being able to reach into those facts with Ansible was pretty neat and pretty convenient.
So we threw this slide up here because it is such a win to be able to not have to actually really touch anything. It's like magic, right?
It's a lot of like really boring work putting a disk into every server and installing it.
You can go focus on actually working on really cool things. So some other cool things about this project, there are a lot of plugins, and actually you have the capability with the REST API forum. If you like to write, you can actually create your own plugins with some of the neat plugins that they have. We have Docker plugins now, also Chef, Salt, and M Collective. So you can go to this link and check the list of plugins. It grows weekly.
I wanted to mention M Collective support. So one of the most annoying things about Puppet to me is that it pulls. So you might have to wait 30 minutes, and you're not guaranteed on the first run for everything you've done, so you might have to run twice. So you might have to wait an hour for your Puppet thing to actually apply to all your servers. M Collective wants to run instantly. If you have it integrated, it adds a run now button to the UI, the web UI. So I'm like, it's almost like Ansible. Yeah, so go now, get it on the stuff I want.
Turn the light on to tell us to shut
the No, we're good. We've got 10 more minutes.
Somewhat on top of the computer, but do you do a multi-data server?
No, not yet. I'm only doing my.
I'm going to chat with you later.
Okay.
So the last thing we have here is just a demo we recorded this morning. I was really excited to hear about the integration with Docker, being able to manage Docker with the foreman.
And we had this on YouTube, but there's no internet here, so.
Okay, so basically here, you define what's called a compute resource. You create a Docker compute resource, and I'm just going to run this locally on Foreman. The username and password that you saw there was just my username and password to Docker Hub. So here I'm going to create a new Jenkins container on the compute resource that I just defined. So I have the ability here to do a search of GitHub. I'll pull down the latest Jenkins image. For Docker Hub to pull down the latest Jenkins image. Give it a name, and then execute the actual command to
things can all be driven through APIs, so you can hook this in your scripts if you want.
Yeah, so you have the ability to do environment variables, expose ports, which is a little flaky. I'll explain why in a minute. And then you can go ahead and tell it to go ahead and run it right away. So now you can see that it's running. You have the ability to actually look at the logs from Docker. So when I go to my forming machine, you can actually see that Jenkins is running. So if you look at the way that Docker is running, the Jenkins image is running, you can see 8080 exposed. That's only on the container. So currently right now in Foreman, I can't actually forward the port across from the container 8080 to the host 8080. The only way I can do that is actually running it from my from the actual Docker server, the Docker host. So another cool feature about Foreman here is that I can actually start another container on the host that I defined in my compute resource, and then I can actually flip back over to Foreman, and that new container that I just created and I'm running will actually be sitting on top of the Foreman UI, and then I can actually control it from here, which I found to be really cool.
So you can actually give it a random name too, if you don't specify names. Yeah. It's
kind of fun to see what it names it. The only thing I will say though is that I haven't figured out how to actually expose the ports properly. That might be as simple as adding a good environment variable or a better environment variable within the image.
We heavily suspect it's possible, because without that it would be pretty useless. We just haven't figured out how to do it yet.
Yeah.
And this has been a low priority relative to the work stuff we're using it for at work already.
Just fun. One other thing about this is the fact that this, I only have the ability to define a single Docker host as a compute resource. If you're trying for high availability, we all know that that is not good. So I don't know if there's a way maybe you could deploy this into like Docker Swarm or Mesos or something for orchestration. So I would expect there to be lots more to come with this plugin.
Yeah, there definitely will be, because they intend to use it in my company for all control of all Docker, and they don't realize any limitations yet, so we'll probably get new tickets for that. It's kind of a problem.
And the last thing we had here is just a couple ways to get started. I highly, highly, highly suggest using the Foreman documentation, because the Catello documentation is non-existent. It will cause you a lot of heartache. And like what he said, if you have a Red Hat account, use the Red Hat Satellite 6 documentation to it. Like I said, this is the open source project behind Red Hat 6, Satellite 6.
Yeah, if you look at the bug tracker for Catello, it's mostly people that work at Red Hat fixing the bugs. Although the project lead, I don't think, works there. But
anytime there's a bug opened up in Red Hat Satellite 6, there's always one opened up here. It was either opened up here first, or there's a duplicate.
The name of Red Hat product you just mentioned, something 6, Satellite 6. Is the documentation available for folks who don't have a subscription?
I believe so. I'm not 100% on that. I've always had the account, but I believe so, yes.
Okay, thanks.
But like as far as like deep documentation, I don't know about that. And like as far as being able to look at tickets.
How did you guys handle DNS registration and or unregistration for hosts?
So the way I'm doing it, since I don't have control over Windows DNS servers, I made Foreman a DNS server and it's doing pass-through. So everything will talk to Foreman first and then pass through to the Windows servers. And Foreman itself, as a DNS server, will do that as well.
You can actually define in Foreman, there's another tab where you can actually predefine your domains. And then you assign those domains that you create there along with IP pools to your host group. So it knows if you want to use DHCP, for example, where you have an IP pool, when you can actually also assign static IPs too.
Well, I haven't pulled static IPs out of the IP pool.
Well, yeah. You can actually create your own domains and then assign them to host groups. It would probably be the easiest way I would do that.
And then the slides with videos embedded are on that URL if you ever need a copy.
Or feel free to reach out to you. Either one of us or both of us, if you have any interest.
So if you're in a Debian environment and you don't want to use Puppet,
use Mass.
No, I mean, how much functionality do you think you make it?
No, I mean, you can, like, there's a chef plugin that you can use.
Or Salt.
Or use an Ansible.
Or Salt, yeah, and like he said, there is actually Ansible integration now for the plugin.
You lose a ton
can
of
you still do, like, virtualization deployment?
Oh, yeah, you can still do
oh, yeah.
Still,
yeah.
Just the management stuff.
Yeah, because, yeah, through the deployment process.
Can you do, like, kick off Ansible?
Yeah, you can. You, there's a plugin called HookScripts where you can have between any step of the process, they just call it script that you want. And then you can also put the scripts into your Kickstarter.